Ja.
Året er 2004, og Danmark har hele verdens opmærksomhed, da kronprins Frederik gifter sig med australske Mary Donaldson. Ved brylluppet er dronninger og prinsesser fra Europas kongehuse repræsenteret, og alle bærer strålende kongelige juveler. Dette er beretningen om juvelerne i den svenske og danske kongefamilie. Om disse historiske pragtsmykker, som i dag er så sjældne og enestående, at de end ikke kan vurderes.
We don't count the carats. We count the centuries.
Bag disse kostbare ædelstene gemmer sig dramatiske familiehistorier, omgæret af drama og ulykke. Men også stor kærlighed og lykke. Historien tager sin begyndelse med et pragtfuldt rubinsæt, der fremstilles til Napoleons kroning for mere end 200 år siden. Og som i dag bæres af den danske kronprinsesse.
I'd never seen such a set before, or had no idea of the historical significance of the ruby set.
Helt ekstraordinært har den danske og svenske dronning givet tilladelse til at filme deres juveler. Samt vise familiens private film og fotos.
For special occasions, when you put on your best, you put on your best jewelry as well. If it's a wedding which is held in the afternoon and finishes with an evening, then tiaras will be worn, even though it's bright daylight. There is more sentiment attached to quite a lot of jewelry than people might think. Certainly, jewelry which has been passed through families, even though they can perfectly well survive in a bank box or in a museum, there is something special about jewelry which is actually worn, because they were made to be worn.
Få dage før brylluppet tiltrækker bruden sig ekstra opmærksomhed, da hun bærer et helt specielt kongeligt smykkesæt.
My great grandmother was a Swedish princess. And she brought to Denmark a set of rubies and diamonds, a tiara, a necklace, very fine earrings, and a great brooch. And the story of that is that it belonged to Queen Désirée of Sweden, the first Bernadotte Queen of Sweden. And she is supposed to have worn them at Napoleon's coronation.
Og det er netop dette rubinsæt, som Mary Donaldson bliver præsenteret for få dage før sit bryllup med kronprins Frederik. Som kommende kronprinsesse af Danmark skal hun nu bære de smykker, som præcis 200 år forinden blev båret til Napoleons kroning i Paris.
When the ruby set was presented to me by my husband and my coming mother-in-law, I was very overwhelmed. I'd never actually seen such a set before, and for me as a newcomer to the royal family to think that I should wear this is of course a very overwhelming thought, because this set of jewelry has such a history and has been worn by some very significant women and has belonged to various royal families and has been part of the making of history.
Det enestående rubinsæt er med til at fortælle en usædvanlig historie, der tager sin begyndelse i Frankrig, hvor Napoleon i 1804 kroner sig selv til kejser. Til kroningen bæres rubinsættet af Napoleons tidligere forlovede, Désirée. 9 år tidligere har Napoleon forelsket sig i den smukke Désirée Clary, og hun er bestemt ikke uinteresseret.
Bonaparte was in love with Désirée Clary, and he asked for her hand, and Monsieur Clary, the father, who was a silk trader in Marseille, said, I don't want this Bonaparte. Not only is he poor, but he has no future at all. So he said no. And finally, they found another man who apparently had future, but I don't see which one at that time, who was Bernadotte.
Désirée trouve Bernadotte à son goût et elle devient Madame la Générale Bernadotte. Et en même temps, Napoléon, lui, trouve Joséphine, dont il tombe amoureux, et l'un épouse Joséphine. Mais il a toujours aimé Désirée.
Jean-Baptiste Bernadotte est un des Napoléons dygtigste généraux. Og ved kroningen befinder han og Désirée i Napoleons nærmeste følge. Og Désirée har næppe i sin vildeste fantasi forestillet sig, at hun blot 6 år senere skal blive svensk kronprinsesse. Ikke siden solkongens velmagtsdage på slottet i Versailles har Frankrig oplevet en pragt som nu.
Pour de nouveau rendre le prestige, la brillance, toute la force, on peut dire, de la propagande, en montrant que la France est toujours la plus grande puissance. Napoléon prête des sommes astronomiques à ses 18 maréchaux en leur disant « Achetez pour vos épouses des parures qui mettront la splendeur du couronnement en évidence. »
They were part of the political propaganda. We are the richest, we are the grandest, we put jewels everywhere.
Désirées juvelsæt er inspireret af naturen og består af små elegante blade i diamanter og røde bær, formet af små rubiner, som hører til blandt de dyre ædelstene. I sit hår bærer Désirée 8 juvelbuketter, som matcher halskæden, brochen og ørelokkerne. I dag bærer den danske kronprinsesse et diadem, der er skabt ud af buketterne til håret, mens resten af sættet er uforandret.
Napoleon's is the time when jewelry began to be made up in set pieces and not just bits and pieces that you could sew onto clothes, put in your hair. That is when the tiara starts and the great parure and when it all has to match.
På verdensplan er smykkesproget fransk, og parure er den franske betegnelse for et stort juvelsæt.
They went on being fashionable right the way through the 19th century and into the 20th. That's why they've been preserved to a certain extent anyway.
Den svenske konge Gustav den 4. Adolf drager i krig mod Napoleon, som han hader indet. Kongen er både snæversynet og ubegavet, og ignorerer, at Napoleon har allieret sig med Rusland. Kongen taber krigen og må afgive Finland til Rusland.
That was a catastrophe to Sweden, and they then made him abdicate, or rather they deposed him, and he was sent in exile. Then a youngish officer, called Count Murner, said that he thought he knew who they ought to go and find. Because in Sweden, the whole thing at that time was, we must get back Finland. And how do you get back Finland? Well, you go and find somebody who is a clever general. So they thought, where are the clever generals? Well, they were all at Napoleon's place. So he went down and asked the then Marshal Bernadotte whether he would accept to be adopted Crown Prince of Sweden. And he said yes.
Bernadottes hustru Désirée elsker livet ved hoffet i Paris. Og hun får et chok, da det går op for hende, at hun skal flytte til Sverige, som hun dårligt ved, hvor ligger.
Désirée was, she wasn't stupid, but she wasn't particularly interested in things going on around her, and certainly not in politics. She was a happy-go-lucky, I think, pretty little person. She did come to Sweden, but found it terribly cold, terribly dark, and very forbidding. She said that in Sweden there are 2 winters. One is white, and the other is green.
Désirée kan ikke holde livet ved det gammeldags hof ud. Og efter få måneder beslutter hun at forlade sin mand og sønnen Oscar, der blot er 11 år gammel.
She had a long-standing affair with a French gentleman in Paris, and I think that may be another reason why she wasn't particularly interested in staying in Stockholm.
Jean-Baptiste er blevet kong Karl den 14. Johan af Norge og Sverige, og som konge har han vundet svenskernes tillid og sympati.
He was exceptionally intelligent and he was a hard worker too. He saw in which chaotic situation Sweden was with a huge debt and he paid with his own private fortune, he paid the debt, the official debt of Sweden.
I 12 år har han ikke set sin hustru, og sønnen Oscar er i mellemtiden blevet giftemoden, og kongen begynder at lede efter en passende brud. Og valget falder på den pure unge Josefina af Leuchtenberg.
She was very young when she married. I think she was 16 years old. And she was the granddaughter of the French Empress Josephine. She was the goddaughter of Napoleon. And of course this was very important for Jean-Baptiste Bernadotte because she, Josephine, belonged to the aristocracy and she was French. And she made that Queen Désirée came to Sweden, back again.
Efter 12 år i Frankrig er Désirée tilbage som Sveriges dronning. Og da hun dør i 1860, går rubinsættet, som hun bar til Napoleons kroning, videre til svigerdatteren Josefina, som nu er dronning af Sverige. Josefina kommer til at eje en meget stor samling juveler, i det hun arver smykker fra meget velhavende kvinder i familien. Hun arver juveler fra sin svigermor Désirée, farmoren kejserinde Josefine og søsteren, der er kejserinde af Brasilien, og endelig moren, der er hertuginde af Leuchtenberg. Et af de mest imposante juvelsæt, som Josefina arver fra sin mor, er Leuchtenberg-safirerne, der angiveligt var en gave fra kejser Napoleon, da moren giftede sig med kejserens stedsøn.
It's an excellent, magnificent piece of jewel. This is a very dark blue sapphire. It's beautiful, and you have the diadem, you have the brooch, but you have also little pins which you can use in your hair. And of course you have the earrings. It's easy to wear. It's not heavy. You can close it and you can have it half open like a diadem, or you can have it as a crown. So you have lots of possibilities and it's very practical because it's flat. It's very easy to transport it. All other diadem, they are quite complicated to take with you.
Blandt de mange herligheder i Josefinas store samling er det meget store diamantdiadem, som stammer fra Brasilien.
There have never been any written paper about it, and no, let's say, paintings where you could follow it. But then we found in the testament of Queen Josephine, when she is writing about the Brazilian diadem. So we believe that it came to Sweden by inheritance from her sister, who was the Empress of Brazil, Amelie. She had married Dom Pedro I, and this for me is of course a little special because as you know, my mother was Brazilian and Empress Amelie was very much loved in Brazil.
Den portugisiske kongefamilie er under Napoleonskrigene flygtet til kolonien i Brasilien. Da kongen vender tilbage til Portugal, bliver hans ældste søn i landet og udråber sig selv til kejser Pedro den 1. Af Brasilien.
One of my favorite ancestors is the Emperor Peter the 1st of Brazil. His life is like an adventure, more than Alexandre Dumas could invent. He invented the modern Brazil. He invented the independence of Brazil. He was very naughty. He had many mistresses, many legitimate children, endless stories. Well, anyway, he married first Archduchess Maria Leopoldina, and she died there, poor darling. And rumor was spread in Europe that she died of sadness because of the many mistresses of her husband. So when he tried to find another princess to marry, all the grand houses of Europe, royal, said, no, we don't want another one to have the cruel fate of poor Archduchess Maria Leopoldina. So he found as his second wife what was considered not the first class of royalty, Amélie of Leuchtenberg. And she was very beautiful, charming, immensely popular in Brazil. And oddly enough, they were very happy together. It was a bright couple.
Pedro og Amélie får en datter, men hun dør af tuberkulose som 22-årig. Og da Amélie dør i 1873, bliver det søsteren Josefina i Sverige, som arver Amélies store samling af kostbarheder. I arven indgår blandt andet et enormt sølvservice, som blev brugt ved middagen til kronprinsesse Victorias bryllup, nogle markante smaragder, samt det meget kostbare og usædvanlige smukke diamantsæt.
It's a beautiful tiara. Complicated to wear because it's heavy and it moves. So it's not so easy to fix it. But it's a beautiful ensemble. It has also earrings. They're magnificent.
Diamanterne i hver ørering er uovertruffen i farve og kvalitet. Og med deres vægt på 30 karat hver, er de på størrelse med et vagtlæg. Sættet har aldrig tidligere været vist samlet. Men det svenske kongehus har helt ekstraordinært givet tilladelse til at fotografere sættet i sin helhed.
This we only wear in very, very, very special occasions. On state's visit or other important occasions like His Majesty's 60th birthday, for instance. I wore it on Crown Princess Victoria's wedding. And I will never take it outside the country either.
Dronning Silvia gjorde dog en enkelt undtagelse ved det svenske statsbesøg i Danmark i 2007.
Wearing it in Denmark, that was a very special occasion. We are so close, not only friends, but also family-wise, so that's why. I was thinking, what should I wear? What would Queen Margrethe like to see? All those tiaras, of course, are very well known to her. So I thought the Brazilian diadem is perhaps unique. So then I thought, you know, queen to queen. I thought it would be nice to wear it.
Til det brasilianske diamantdiadem bærer dronning Silvia ofte et sæt enestående russiske topaser. Dronningen er fotograferet med disse pragtsmykker i 1976.
I have been wearing it also for my first official picture. You see the Brazilian diadem, but you see also the edel topaz necklace. And it's a pink topaz of a very, very high quality. They are of extreme beauty. And we know that it's made in St. Petersburg. It was apparently given from the Tsar to his daughter Marie. And then it went over to Sachsen, and then to Prussia, and from Prussia to Baden, and then from Baden to Sweden. It's one of those pieces of arts and piece of jewelry who have been traveling through the whole of Europe, and this makes things extremely interesting, of course.
Til gallaforestillingen i operaen under det svenske statsbesøg bærer kronprinsesse Victoria et pragtfuldt sæt ametyster, der også stammer fra Josefinas store samling.
Crown Princess Victoria, she has worn it, and it's a color which fits her very well. The amethysts are beautiful stones. They're very big. And then you have this very, very heavy necklace. We haven't changed anything, but I wear it very often as a diadem.
Det er dronning Silvias egen idé at montere den tunge halskæde på en ramme, så man på denne måde får et lukket diadem. Til sættet hører også to armbånd, der til gengæld kan hæftes sammen til en halskæde.
Queen Josephine, she had quite an important collection of parures. And the emeralds, they were very significant, of course, because they had a special story.
Under 2. verdenskrig kommer smaragdsættet til den norske kongefamilie under dramatiske omstændigheder. Den norske kronprins Olav er gift med den svenske prinsesse Märta. Da krigen bryder ud, må kronprinsparet flygte. Olav rejser til England med sin far, som regerer Norge fra sit eksil i London. Märta skal til Amerika for at være i sikkerhed med børnene. Heriblandt Norges nuværende konge. Märta rejser til Sverige, og inden flugten går videre, mødes hun med sin svenske mor, prinsesse Ingeborg, på centralstationen i Stockholm. Ingeborg har pakket smaragderne i en taske, som hun giver datteren ved afskeden. Ingen ved, hvornår de vil se hinanden igen.
Princess Ingeborg told her daughter, please take these jewels and if you need money, don't hesitate to sell it, because they went to an exile then and had to leave Norway.
Märta opholder sig i Amerika under 2. verdenskrig, og i løbet af de 5 år ser hun kun sin mand en enkelt gang, da Olav kommer på en kort visit. I 1945, efter Norges befrielse, vender hun tilbage til Oslo og genforenes med Olav.
Fortunately, the family came back to Norway, and so did the emeralds, which you can admire them with Queen Sonja nowadays, and it fits her very well because it's her colors, and it's a beautiful tiara.
I 2010 er der bryllup i Sverige, da kronprinsesse Victoria gifter sig med Daniel Westling. Til brylluppet er familiemedlemmer fra alle de europæiske kongehuse inviteret, og kvinderne bærer de uvurderlige historiske juvelsæt. Kronprinsesse Victoria bærer et diadem med kameer sat i guld og perler, som også stammer fra Josefina. Kameerne er konkyljeskaller udskåret i relief, så motivet træder tydeligt frem i kontrasten mellem det hvide og bleget røde lag. Dette sæt har også sin helt særlige historie. Det er fremstillet til Josefinas farmor, kejserinde Josefine, i 1809 af Napoleons hofjuveler Nitto.
For a mother, it's a big, big moment of your life when you see your own daughter coming into the church. And of course, wearing the diadem. You have been wearing. I saw the beauty of the tiara and her happiness.
Ni är nu man och hustru.
If God was to describe you,
kvinderne i den svenske kongefamilie bærer i dag kamererne, der fortæller den symbolske historie om menneskepigen Psyke og elskovsguden Amor, der skal gå så gruelig meget igennem for til sidst at få hinanden.
I had only one wish. I hoped so much that she would find the same happiness as I had. And it was a very harmonic picture of her, her happiness, the tiara, the veil.
Det lever!
I know also that for His Majesty, it was a very special moment too, knowing that his mother has borne it. It was beautiful.
I 200 år har en kejserinde, dronninger og prinsesser båret kamelerne. Også dronning Margrethes mor, der var svensk prinsesse, har båret dette sjældne smykkesæt.
In the early 30s, they made a big evening in Stockholm in aid of some charity. And various Swedish ladies were dressed up as various queens of Sweden. And my mother took the part of Queen Josephine of Sweden and wore that tiara and a dress which was made to look like something that in a portrait of Queen Josephine.
I 1869 skifter dronning Josefinas barnebarn, Louisa, sig med den danske kronprins Frederik. Under bryllupsfestlighederne i Stockholm bærer hun dele af Désirées rubinsæt, og farmoren, dronning Josefina, bestemmer, at rubinsættet nu skal følge Louisa til Danmark.
The ruby set was given to Princess Louisa as a wedding gift from Queen Josephina. And when giving the gift to her, she stated that the Danish colors must go to Denmark.
Louisa er nu kronprinsesse i Danmark. Året efter brylluppet dør hendes mormor i Holland. Og inden for 2 år mister Louisa også sine forældre. Og hun arver dermed en enorm samling juveler fra både Sverige og Holland. Louisa er blot 20 år. Som helt ung kronprinsesse har hun juveler, som er en dronning værdig.
It was said that if you laid all the jewelry out on a large billiard table, that you would be unable to see the table underneath.
I Louisas store arv indgår også et pragtfuldt perlepoir-diadem fra Holland, som passer perfekt sammen med en halskæde og øresmykker, som hun får i bryllupsgave af visekongen af Egypten.
I honestly don't know why the Khedive was in the mood to give such a splendid present to the future Crown Princess of Denmark. But anyway, she did have these splendid jewels, which are also pear-shaped pearls, and which match beautifully with the tiara. And she used that a lot, and which is also some jewelry that I've used for special occasions.
I 1898 leder den danske prins Christian, Louisa og Frederik den 8. søn, efter en passende brud.
My grandfather, who was a young man, went for a trip around Europe to visit various princesses and really fell for this young, rather charming, very shy Princess Alexandrine. They were married a year later than that should have been because her father died. And so the wedding was not made a very grand occasion. And they were married privately in Cannes. She was very young when she married. She was only just 19, I think. And then she came to Denmark and lived the rest of her life here.
Ved brylluppet forærer Louisa sin nye svigerdatter et diadem, som hun specielt har lavet fremstille af brocherne med vinblade og små bær fra Désirées rubinsæt. Resten af sættet, halskæden, ørelokkerne og flere brocher beholder Louisa nu alligevel selv.
Queen Alexandrine was my paternal grandmother. And her mother was a Russian Grand Duchess. She was called Anastasia Mikhailovna. Being a Russian princess, she brought a great lot of splendid jewelry into the family in Mecklenburg, and my grandmother, of course, inherited quite a lot of that jewelry, which is how she brought some very beautiful jewelry to Denmark.
Blandt Alexandrines smykker er et pragtfuldt diadem, som stammer fra Rusland. Alexandrines mor fik diademet i bryllupsgave af sin farbror, zar Alexander den anden. Diademet er også kendt fra de danske sardindåser, hvor Alexandrines portræt den dag i dag bryder æsken.
She was a very modest, really a shy person. But she would, for great occasions, she would put on the jewelry that we would expect her to. But I remember that she did not wear a lot of jewelry. I remember her as a child. I was 12 when she died, so I remember her very well.
I april 2010 er kongelige familiemedlemmer fra hele Europa i København for at fejre dronning Margrethes 70-års fødselsdag.
I celebrated my 70th birthday in April of 2010, and for that occasion we had several possibilities of wearing our best, and so I wore, for one of the evenings, I wore the emeralds from Rosenborg, and I wore the pear-shaped pearls at another evening, and then I wore the three-part flower tiara on the third occasion.
Hvad er 70 år?
Igennem alle årene har de kongelige familier indkøbt juveler. Blomsterdiademet, som dronningen bærer til sin fødselsdag, har hendes far, kong Frederik den 9. købt.
The first time it was used, my mother wore it for my wedding. It can be mounted on a frame to make a tiara. It is also possible to mount it is in three different parts. You can fix this sort of jewelry in many ways, which I enjoy. I like wearing it in slightly differently from time to time, and I think my hairdresser enjoys doing it up like that too.
Kære mor, en smuk dronning, en gæv pige. Tillykke.
Danske kronjuveler er permanent udstillet på Rosenborg Slot. De tilhører den danske stat og bæres kun af den til enhver tid siddende danske dronning. Som det eneste sted i verden bærer smykkerne af statsoverhovedet, samtidig med at de også er udstillet.
The crown jewels of Denmark are used by the queen, which is now me, but it would be my son's wife one day. I always, and I know my mother did too, always feel a great responsibility because they are not personal property the way other jewelry we wear is. And they are exposed and shown at the Rosenborg so that the public will see them. So we don't take them out for very long and not too often either. But I also know that people find it interesting when they are missing, that the fact is that that's because they're actually being used. They're not just museum pieces. And I think it makes them more alive.
Kronjuvelerne bliver oprettet i 1747, da Christian den 6. dronning Sofie Magdalene testamenterer og stiller sin private samling til rådighed for fremtidige dronninger i Danmark. Samlingen består primært af fire store smykkesæt. To med diamanter, et med rubiner og perler, samt et smaragdsæt. Smaragderne regnes for en overordentlig fin samling, da stenene er meget rene, med en dyb, klar og stærk farve. Det kostbareste juvelsæt, dronningen af Danmark bærer, er brillantsættet. Diamanterne har siden 1700-tallet været i kongehusets eje. og de er med deres alder en meget stor sjældenhed. Til brillantsættet ynder dronningen at bære blomsterdiademet. Den midterste firkantede diamant i kæden har tidligere siddet i en ring, som har tilhørt den ulykkelige Caroline Mathilde. Hun måtte aflevere ringen, inden hun blev sendt i eksil, efter sin kærlighedsaffære med Struense, kongens livlæge. Kæden med de 19 store perler er det ældste smykke i samlingen, og kan dateres helt tilbage til 1600-tallet. Og perlerne vidner om et stort drama i den danske kongefamilie.
There has been some speculation that they might have belonged to a princess called Eleonore Christine, who was imprisoned by her half-brother, who was the king. It's a long and complicated story, but she had a lot of jewelry. She was extremely rich. I think her husband had made off with quite a lot of the state funds. But anyway, she was imprisoned for a very, very long time, and the then queen confiscated her jewelry. She's portrayed with pearls of that kind, but most great ladies of those days would have had that sort of pearl, and if they didn't, they would be painted with them.
I 1947 bliver dronning Margrethes mor, Ingrid, dronning af Danmark, og får dermed ret til at bære kronjuvelerne. Men kæden med de 19 perler har mistet fordomsglans.
These pearls hadn't been used for a very long time, and they were definitely in bad shape. It's important that pearls should be worn again next to the skin. It keeps them bright and shining. My mother borrowed them from Rosenborg, and for the first many weeks, even months, she didn't wear them openly. She simply wore them under her clothes. She wore them actually at night, so to give them a chance of reacquiring their luster. And they did, and they are very beautiful now.
Dronning Ingrids mor, prinsesse Margaret, er den engelske dronning Victorias barnebarn og dermed en af Europas mest eftertragtede prinsesser. I januar 1905 møder hun den svenske tronfølger Gustav Adolf, og 4 uger senere forlover de sig i pyramidernes land.
For the wedding at Windsor, very many people were invited. But here the Khedive of Egypt, he played a kind of a role, because they met and they were very thankful toward him. And of course he was delighted to accept being invited. And he came with the most beautiful tiara in diamonds, which was made by Cartier.
Cartier-diademet er hovedsmykket i dronning Ingrids juvelarv fra sin mor. Selv bærer hun det meget ofte, og det får en fremtrædende rolle, da hun lader sine 3 døtre bære det til deres bryllupper.
When my younger sister and me married, I think my mother thought it would be suitable to wear as a bride, because it's very pretty, light, it's not a heavy one, and she was very young, it was suitable. And then, of course, because she had worn it, my elder sister and I also were allowed to wear it. And of course, it was a wonderful thing to wear one's grandmother's tiara with the history and all. It was lovely, very lovely. Next generation, my younger sister's eldest daughter Alexia and my eldest daughter Alexandra each wore it for their respective weddings.
I dag ejes Cartier-diademet af den yngste af de 3 søstre, Grækenlands tidligere dronning Anne Marie, som bar det til prins Joachims og prinsesse Maries bryllup i 2008. Efter brylluppet i London i 1905 ankommer Margareta og Gustav Adolf til Sverige, hvor de modtages af det begejstrede folk i et festpyntet Stockholm. Parret får 5 børn, heriblandt Ingrid som den eneste pige, og som senere bliver dronning af Danmark. Da Margareta er gravid med parrets 6. barn, får hun en mellemørebetændelse, som udvikler sig til blodforgiftning, og hun dør pludselig. Hun er gravid i 8. måned, og heller ikke barnet overlever.
It was a terrible blow for my mother when she died, and my mother was 10. She died from 5 children. But she was a very remarkable woman. She was never forgotten, and her memory is very much alive in Sweden too, I think, and certainly in my family.
I sit testamente har Margareta bestemt, at hendes brudeslør ved hendes død skal dække hende i kisten, men ikke følge hende i graven. Når kisten lukkes, skal sløret fjernes og gå i arv til datteren Ingrid. Femten år efter Margaretas død har Ingrid forelsket sig i den 11 år ældre danske kronprins Frederik, og brylluppet står i Stockholms Storkirke. Ingrid bærer et kært minde om sin afdøde mor, det fint kniplede brudeslør, som også Margareta bar ved sit bryllup.
Crown Princess Margaret hoped that her daughter, Princess Ingrid, would also wear it later on her wedding day. Queen Ingrid, in fact, wore the lace as well on her wedding day. And since then, all of her descendants have worn this beautiful Irish lace veil. And I was also very honored to wear it on my wedding day.
Dronning Margrethe har ikke døtre til at bære det brudeslør, som blev fremstillet til hendes mormor i 1905. Og derfor bestemmer hun helt ekstraordinært, at Margrethas slør også skal bæres af Danmarks nye kronprinsesse. Efter brylluppet forlader Ingrid sit fædreland som ny kronprinsesse af Danmark. Og sammen med sin mand sejler hun til Danmark med kongeskibet Dannebrog. Ved ankomsten hyldes det smukke kronprinspar af den danske befolkning, og Ingrid bærer en ny diamantbroche.
When my mother was married, her father gave her a brooch in the shape of a daisy, which, because my grandmother's name was Daisy, she was called Margaret, but she was always known as Daisy. And so he had a beautiful daisy made out of diamonds which had belonged to my grandmother, and gave it to my mother, who wore it for her wedding. And then when I was married, she let me wear it for my wedding too. And then 10 years ago, when I was 60 on my birthday, my mother had just turned 90. She gave me the daisy brooch, which I must say I was extremely touched to be given it like that. Well, it's a brooch which means a great lot to me. First, because it was my mother's, and then again because I wore it for my wedding, and then I was given it the way I was given it like that when I was 60. That's very special.
I brudgave får Ingrid af sine danske svigerforældre det pragtfulde rubinsæt, der blev fremstillet til Napoleons kroning. Ved kong Christian den 10. hof hersker en vis kasernestemning. Kongen har en militær ledelsesstil og en meget spartansk livsindstilling. Men Ingrid er med sin moderløse opvækst på Stockholms slot vant til at omgås vrisne gamle mænd. Og hun vinder sin svigerfars hjerte. Under 2. verdenskrig kommer kronprinsparets første barn, prinsesse Margrethe, til verden. Hun skal senere blive dronning af Danmark efter sin far, Frederik den 9. To år efter kommer de to søstre, prinsesse Benedikte og prinsesse Anne Marie, til. Pigerne bliver lidt ældre, får de lov til at gå på opdagelse i deres mors smykkeskrin.
Perhaps we even said, "Oh, mommy, can we please look at your jewels?" And we would look and take them out, of course, very carefully, because we knew that they were old and delicate.
Og ved en privat teaterforestilling på Fredensborg i 1954 får Benedikte endda lov til at bære rubinsættet, klædt ud som dronning Désirée.
My mother made a sketch. Because she in fact had the dress that Queen Désirée wore for the coronation of Napoleon. And I was sort of in the height more than anything that I could fit this dress. And that was of course very special. And I felt very proud and I was very anxious to do the right thing and not stumble and, you know. And my younger sister, she was Oscar I, and very sweet, I must say. There's some very lovely pictures of that sketch.
Fra sin mor har prinsesse Benedikte arvet det mere end 150 år gamle perlestjernediadem, som stammer fra den svenske kongefamilie. Det har tilhørt prinsessens tibollemor, dronning Sofia, som fik det i bryllupsgave i 1857.
It's a really lovely tiara. You don't so often see such sort of high pearl poise. So today I have the privilege of wearing it, and I have on special occasions lent it to each of my two daughters, Alexandra and Natalie.
Rubinsættet bliver Ingrids foretrukne juvelsæt gennem mere end 6 årtier.
My mother used to wear it a lot. It was her favorite piece of jewelry. I've never worn it because my mother had it all the time and she wore it also when she was a widow. And then she left it to Frederick. The idea is that that is to stay with the crown prince or king in Denmark. And we waited a few years until Frederick was married and then we could see the beautiful jewelry again.
Kronprinsesse Mary bærer rubinsættet for allerførste gang ved den officielle gallamiddag 4 dage før sit bryllup.
That first evening where I wore the ruby set, there was so much new. There was so much overwhelming for me. It wasn't just the jewelry, it was the significance of the whole event, of the whole period, the whole time which I was going through. So I don't really think I thought so much about what I had on in terms of jewelry, except that it felt new and somewhat unusual to have such a significant and beautiful piece of jewelry on. Everything that was going on at that time was part of a very new and overwhelming time. I mean, it wasn't just the jewelry, it was also the dress. I mean, I've never worn a dress like this before, or the whole thing was overwhelming.
Rubinsættet er gået i arv til kronprins Frederik fra hans elskede mormor, og nu skal den nye kronprinsesse føre arven videre.
This set was belonging to Queen Ingrid, that was very much loved and admired by the Danish people. And here was I, coming from Australia, about to marry their crown prince. So at that time, it felt very much like I was loaning this set. And it's, I suppose, a process that one goes through, and over time, you start to feel like that you can wear it in your own right. But as the years have progressed, it's felt much more that it's mine, and that I wear it as Crown Princess Mary.
I enjoy seeing it on her very much.
Queen Ingrid usually wore it as a complete set, but in the last few years, I've worn it in many variations. Of course, in the start, you want to make sure you don't offend anyone by doing the wrong thing or wearing the jewelry in a way that it's not meant to be worn. I naturally discussed it with my mother-in-law, how it could be used and not used, but she's also very creative with the way she uses jewelry. So she was always very open to my ideas on it. I mean, I've changed the earrings, for example, that they can be worn as just a solitaire, a single earring, so the long pendant can be taken off and then you can attach a pearl. Or I've worn the brooch as something to gather part of my dress. The tiara without the large necklace, or without the brooch. I like to play with it a little bit.
Diademet, der blev fremstillet til dronning Ingrids svigermor Alexandrine, blev båret som pandebånd. Da moden skifter, ændrer dronning Ingrid diademet, så det nu sidder oppe på hovedet og fylder noget mere.
Very often things are reset. For example, the tiara. My mother had the two little brooches added to the tiara, so that to fill it out a bit more, because it suited my mother to have a slightly bigger sort of tiara. I know that the Crown Princess has also adjusted the tiara a little bit so that it suits her face and shape better, which I think is perfectly normal, and I think it's a very good idea.
I've just done it recently because it's that idea of it was on loan to me, and this tiara that belonged to Queen Ingrid, everyone remembers her in the ruby set. So of course there was a lot of consideration that went into changing the tiara, and it was very important to keep it as much in the spirit of Queen Ingrid. I just wanted to make it more fitting to me. Very little was changed, actually. We removed some of the bouquets from the side, and it was put on a new structure that was fitted to my head, so that today I can wear it as it's meant to be worn, more upright, instead of lying more flat on my head.
Mm-hmm. Juvelerne i de europæiske kongehuse fortæller om stærke familiebånd i mange generationer. Désirées rubinsæt, der blev fremstillet til Napoleons kroning, er gået i arv igennem 200 år. I dag bærer kronprinsesse Mary arven videre i det danske kongehus. I 2006 beslutter dronning Margrethe at forære et af de smykker, som betød meget for dronning Ingrid, til kronprinsesse Mary. Dronning Ingrid arvede safirbrochen fra sin mor Margareta.
I received the brooch when our first child, Prince Christian, was born, and I also wore it at the christening of him.
Hvad er barnets navn?
Christian Valdemar Henri John.
Queen Ingrid usually wore the brooch for family occasions, and I know, for example, that she wore it on the engagement day of my parents-in-law. Later, my mother-in-law, Queen Margaret, inherited the brooch from her mother, and she has also followed somewhat in that tradition and has used the brooch, for example, with the christening of Prince Nikolai. Some people learn history through wars or famous people, but jewelry is just as good a possibility to learn history. It shows how the families have married through the generations, and it doesn't only talk about lineage, but it also relates to personal events in families. For example, we know that this brooch is often worn, has always been worn for family-related events, except that now I have it and I tend to wear it a little bit more generally.